So the title of my message this morning is Winning Life's Battles. And I forgot to add 10 times out of 10. Winning life's battles 10 times out of 10. Right? There is no defeat for the Christian. When I was thinking about this message, I realized that the first arena where we face a battle is in this world. Because the world we live in is a fallen world. It is tainted by sin. Satan rules over those who are living in darkness in this world. All of the misery, the pain, the suffering, the injustice that you see in the newspapers, that you read of, that you watch on television, all of these are because of a sin-tainted human race. The human race has been so tainted with sin that they've given the devil a foothold in their lives, and that's the reason why we see so much of misery and suffering and pain and sorrow in this world. We also see that Satan governs the darkness of this world by a system. And this world system upon which the world operates is described for us in the Bible. And I'd like you to turn to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. First John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. The New King James, please. The Bible says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Verse 16. 16. 16. So the Bible says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever." So the world is governed by this system. The system that governs the world is based on the lust of the flesh. That means getting whatever you need for yourself. The lust of the eyes and the pride of life. So Satan governs the people in darkness of this world using these three aspects. If you look at the papers, you will find that the evil that man is willing to perpetrate on a fellow human being is unimaginable. The evil that takes place in many places of the world and even in this city is sometimes too hard to even comprehend. We wonder how the human heart could be so depraved to sink to such a low. And every time you think you've hit the bottom, there'll be some bright guy who digs a hole and goes deeper. So there is no limit to the depravity of the human being in sin. So what are the battles that we face in this sin-tainted world? We battle against this world system which operates on I, me, and myself. We battle against wicked people. People who are simply wicked. They like to do evil for no other reason than just the fact that they are wicked. The battles that you may face may be a battle with regards to your finances. You may always find yourself with a shortfall, not enough. You may face battles with regards to your job. You just lost a job, or you got trouble at work dealing with people. The battles that you may face may be breakdown in relationships, one problem after another besetting the person, sicknesses of various kinds, people struggling with sicknesses, and there seems to be no end in sight. Battles that people face in simply trying to live a decent life. However, I must say that some of the battles we face are battles of our own making. Right? Isn't that right? Some of the battles we face are battles that we create. Sometimes if you keep your mouth shut, there's not going to be a problem. Right? Sometimes if you do the right thing and live righteously, you're not going to have a problem. But there are some things that we do stupidly, and we create some of the battles that we struggle with. I hope all of us never go down that path where we create some of the battles that we struggle with. Some people commit adultery, and then you have a whole list of stuff happening in your life, and then you begin to cry out to God for help. It won't work. There are some people who are offended by everything that people say. Sometimes you create trouble in your life by simply viewing pornography. You're asking for trouble. The Bible tells us very clearly, Psalm 37, by the words of your lips, I have kept myself away from the paths of the destroyer. The devil has set paths on which he traverses. And if you're wise, you're going to stay away from his paths, right? It's like walking out into the highway and expecting not to be hit by a car. You're going to be hit by a car if you walk blindly on the highway. You stay away from the highway. In the same way, as long as you stay on God's highway, stay out of the devil's terrain, you're not going to get hit. So we mustn't create trouble for ourselves in our lives, but unfortunately we do. The second area where we face battles, the first is the world and our living in the world. The second area where we face battles is simply dealing with the desires of our flesh. Please look at 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11. First Peter 2:11. We need help there because I didn't have the time to put this down on the PowerPoint, but we'll get to where we need to go. First Peter chapter 2 and verse 11. The Bible says, "Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain, stay away from fleshly lusts which war against your soul." So the Bible speaks here of a battle, and that battle is not with your boss or with your neighbor. That battle that the Bible speaks of is against your own, the desires of your flesh. The Bible says these fleshly lusts, the moment you engage fleshly lusts, you create a war in your soul. Your soul speaks of your mind, your will, and your emotions, right? So the moment you give in to your worldly, fleshly lusts, you create a war in your mind. You create a war in your being. Please look at first at Galatians chapter 5 and verse 17. Galatians 5 and verse 17. The Bible says, for the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another. In other words, when you have the Spirit of God living inside of you, the Bible says He will try to keep you from giving in to the desires of your flesh. So there is a kind of a tension between the spirit and the flesh, and if you give in to the flesh, You're going to create a war in your own life. If you give in to the thoughts of oppression, of offense, you give in and keep dwelling on these things, you're going to have trouble. And that's of your creation, you see. There are people who are offended by one another, and when I speak to them, they say, oh, I've forgiven and everything is all fine. But they keep speaking about the same issue. So when you keep speaking about, I was hurt by this person or that person, what does that tell me? It tells me loud and clear that you haven't forgiven. Right? So, the lust of the flesh. Galatians says, it speaks about the works of the flesh. Please go down. Look at verse 19. Galatians 5:19. The Bible says the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness. Next. Idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Some time ago, I came in contact with my school friends. Somebody called me up from Singapore, got my number, called me, and he was from my school friends. And that's like 30-something years ago, right? So, I was wanting to know how these guys are doing. So, I said, and he said, hey, we got a chat group, why don't you sign on? So, I said, I'm fine, why don't you put me onto the chat group? So, this is like 2 weeks ago. And so, I got onto this chat group, and I regretted it within a day. You know why? These guys are all in their 50s, and the topics that they write about and they speak about is simply trash. It's got no value at all. It doesn't build my soul. It brings me under oppression. So I said, hey, this is not the place for me. And I begin to wonder, these guys are in their 50s and they're still so caught up with the lust of the flesh. They're so caught up, their minds are so defiled. I want to have nothing to do with it. Why? Because my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. There will be people in your life who will not build you up, but they will tear you down. They will lead you not towards God, but towards the lust of the flesh, towards the world. Cut them off. You got only one life to live, you better live it well. You're not going to get another chance. Stay away from such things. The Bible tells me clearly, avoid every appearance of evil. Avoid it. Please turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 3 to 5. Just say C-O-R is fine. 2-C-O-R is fine. It'll take you there. 2 Corinthians 10. 10, yeah, thank you. Verse 3 to 5. So when we're speaking about the flesh, I want to show you another area where a war can take place, a battle you can have. And the Bible tells us clearly, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Verse 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. The Bible speaks here of a battle that takes place in the mind. The mind is the arena for a battle. And the devil is going to fight you there to gain control of your thoughts. Because if he can gain control of your thoughts, he can make you dwell on all the wrong things. And the moment your thoughts are set on all the wrong things, you're going to walk in defeat. So the mind is a battleground. Whoever gains control of the mind is a winner. So the Bible says that we have been given spiritual weapons to bring our thoughts under submission to Jesus Christ. How are your thoughts? Do you dwell on your failures, on your past, on your situation, on your circumstances? Do you dwell on your hurts, your pains of the past? If you do, you're not going to be able to break free. You need to be able to bring your mind under control and bring it under the control of the Spirit. You know the extent of depression in Malaysian society? You need to read the statistics. It's mind-boggling, right? The extent of depression, people that struggle with depression, people that struggle with depression even inside of the church, people that struggle with their minds. Of course, there may be various reasons why people have a problem with depression, but one of them is clearly that there's an oppression from the devil. So when you're weighed down with so many issues and troubles in life, then people begin to think that there is no hope left. This is the way my life is going to be. I have no hope. And so depression takes hold. And there's a war that is fought in the mind. Number 3. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 10 to 12. We are looking at arenas where we face a battle. See, whenever you look at anything, you need to ask yourself why. So when the theme of the month is the theme of the month, this month, what is it? The battle belongs to the Lord. Which battle? You need to ask yourself, which battle? What is this battle that we are talking about? And I'm trying to explain to you this morning that the battle that you will face is first in the world. Second, there will be a battle within you against the flesh and in your mind. Third, the Bible says that we have a battle against the forces of darkness. Please look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 12. Ephesians 6, 10 to 12. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So the Bible speaks here clearly of a war that you are in. And that war is not against people, it's not against flesh and blood, but it is against the forces of darkness that rule the kingdom of darkness. And they are going to oppose you at every step. So the Bible says, in order to win this battle, you need to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Take on the full armor of God and fight that battle, because that's the battle that you're going to win. Amen? So the Bible speaks of this. Two weeks ago, I was sharing in our Bible study. 2 weeks ago, I was, 2 or 3 weeks ago, I was at office. And there's a particular floor on the office that we use for evaluation. So there's a lot of security there. So one Friday I went there and I was leaving at around 5:15. And I found that people were quite in a hurry to leave, including the security. So I asked them, what's happening? Then, why is everyone in a hurry to leave? Then the security people said, apparently, two of the female security guards, they saw some black figures following them in the hall, okay? So they were all so worked up and so afraid and so panicking, and they wanted to leave. Nobody wants to stay there, right? So the next week, in between this week and the next week, they did something. Apparently the spirits get spooked when they see black pepper and sugar or something like that. So it was like out of my mind. I couldn't handle that. So I was so amused. So they did what they needed to do. And the next week, Friday, I went there again. This time I asked the male security guard. I said, "Hey, how are things? I heard that you guys saw some spirits or something like that." He told me, "Hey, I saw it." I said, "Oh, okay. So can you explain that to me? Did it look like a human being? Did it look like what?" He said, "It looked like, it was very tall and not with any particular shape, but it had red eyes and it was looking at him. And it scared him totally." So there is a battle that people face sometimes with evil. So I told my friends there. See, when you know, when the word of God has prevailed in your life, you have no fear. So I told him there, when I come in, they clear out. Why? When the light shines in the darkness flees. Amen. In order for that confidence to come in, you need to know that you have been made as righteous as Jesus Christ himself. You moving into a place is as if Jesus moves in there with you. When you are as you realize that you have been made as righteous as Christ, you have no fear when you hear all these kind of stories or any dealing with the demonic in any manner. So you find here that there is a struggle. Please look at 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. The Bible tells us here, 1 Peter 5, 8. The Bible tells us here we have an adversary. We have an opponent. And that opponent is not flesh and blood, but that opponent is Satan himself. So the Bible says here clearly, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil is an adversary. He stands against you and he wants to disrupt your life. Jesus said, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He's a thief. He wants to steal your joy. He wants to steal your success. He wants to steal your finances. He wants to destroy your relationships. He wants to take you to hell. So the Bible warns us clearly that we have an adversary. The Bible tells us also that Satan is an accuser. He keeps accusing you. When you fail, he keeps accusing you, saying it's your fault. When your neighbor dies, the devil accuses you, saying it's your fault. When the cat catches a cold, the devil tells you it's your fault. Because that's the devil's job. He's an accuser. He keeps accusing you of things that you didn't even have anything to do with. So we have these battles, and the arenas of these battles are the world, the flesh, and the devil. Now when you look at the scriptures, you will find that in order to win your battles 10 times out of 10, first you need God. Exodus chapter 17 and verse 15. The background to this chapter is that the city of Amalek was fighting against Israel. Exodus chapter 17. And here, the people of Israel were doing battle with the people of Amalek. Moses was sitting down in prayer. He lifted up his hands with the rod, the staff of God, and he was praying. And as his hands were lifted up, Israel was winning against Amalek. And when he became tired and his hands would go down, Israel would lose the battle. So they propped up his hands. They made him sit on a stone. And as long as he lifted up his hands, the Israelites won the battle against Amalek. And God was trying to show himself to the people of Israel. God was trying to show them that God was involved in every battle of them, of theirs. That's why as long as Moses kept his hands up, Israel was winning. When Moses finished, the Bible says here, verse 15, Moses built an altar and called its name, "The Lord is my banner." In Hebrew, it is Jehovah Nissi. The Lord is my banner. The Lord fights for me. And today, I want you to see that God is your banner. He is the one who fights for you. If you want to win your battles 10 times out of 10, you need to be able to see God as your banner. He is involved in your life. He is involved in your work. He is involved in your friends. He is involved in your neighbors' lives, just because you are a child of God. And you need to see that God is the one who fights for you. There are many battles that we can't fight. God needs to show up. So God would reveal himself to the people of Israel by means of his acts. And one of his acts was that he showed up to fight their battles. So I'd like you to see God in that manner this morning. My banner, the one who fights for me. Please look at 2 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 9. 2 Chronicles 16 and verse 9. Please memorize this verse. It says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to him." 2 Chronicles 16 and 9. 16 verse 9. So the Bible says God is on the lookout for people. He's on the lookout for people whose hearts are loyal to him, because then he shows up and he fights their battles. And when you have God on your side and you are on God's side, you can never lose. Every battle that you face, you will win, because God has shown up in your life. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on your behalf, of those whose hearts are loyal to him. All you need to do is to make sure that you are walking with God, and God shows up in your life every time. Hallelujah. Please look at 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 47. 1 Samuel 17, 47. You know the story of David and Goliath? Yeah, David was facing Goliath. The Philistines were facing Israel. Goliath came out a tall man, 9 feet tall. He threatened the army of Israel. The Israelites were so afraid. David comes forth and he challenges Goliath. And David speaks to Goliath and he says, verse 47. He speaks to Goliath and he says to Goliath that he's going to kill Goliath. And then he continues, "Then all this assembly, including the Israelites and the Philistines, shall know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So when David is facing Goliath, he's facing an insurmountable challenge. The man is probably much taller, much bigger, and has so much of armor. And David was a little shepherd boy armed with sling and stone. But when David looks at Goliath, he recognizes that his God is on his side. He recognizes that God would give Goliath into his hands. He recognizes that although there's a physical arrangement here. You have the Israelites, you have the Philistines, you have David, you have Goliath. He looks above that and he sees in the spirit realm that this is a battle between God, where God is involved. And when God is involved in your life, you can never lose. When God is involved in your life, every Goliath that comes against you, you will bring them down. Not with sword or javelin, but with sling and stone. You can bring them down. It becomes simple, it becomes easy when God shows up. And David says, clearly, the battle is not mine. The battle is the Lord's. It is God's battle, because David's heart was completely surrendered to God. And in the same way, if your heart, your life is totally surrendered to the Lord, guess what? He's going to show up 10 times out of 10. Hallelujah. You only need to look at the Psalms and you will find how wonderfully David speaks of the Lord being his hiding place. Do you understand God now being his hiding place? He is facing an enemy that he cannot overcome. But he has learned through experience that every time he is challenged by an enemy that is too hard, God, he retreats into God. And God becomes his dwelling place. God becomes his hiding place. Psalm 46 says, God is my refuge and my strength, a very present help in trouble. He has learned to let God take charge. You cannot fight your battles and win in your strength. That's the first lesson we need to learn. Sometimes we think, oh, I can do it. I can do it. The Lord is with me. I can do it. I have the wisdom. I have the finances. I have the intellect. I have the education. I can do this. But you will find yourself repeatedly failing until you learn this elementary lesson in your life, and that is, you can do nothing without the Lord. Right? So, what do I do? I want you to see this morning that God is called Jehovah Nissi, the Lord my banner. The Lord is the one who fights your battles. He fights my battles. All I need to do is surrender my life completely to Him. Would you do that? Surrender means total surrender. You don't play with the world after that. Totally yield your life to God. No area in your life must have darkness inside. Don't associate with people who lead you towards sin. Associate with those who build your faith and lead you to greater heights in God. All that you need to do this morning to get this Jehovah Nissi to fight your battles is to surrender your life to Jesus Christ completely. Please don't live a life that is half-hearted. Please don't live a life where you're partly in the world and partly on with God. It's like a boat that is trying to leave the shore, but the anchor is firmly fixed in the ground. That boat is not going anywhere. The Lord wants to fight your battles if you surrender your life to Him. Amen? The second element to help us to win every battle 10 times out of 10 is simply faith. I'd like to explain this because you know that the tagline of our church is placing your faith on the line. So what would you do when you see such things? What in the world does that mean? Right? You need to ask yourself that. Next, what is faith? How do I place it on the line? What is the message here? So if I were to ask you this morning, what do you think is faith? I will get a number of explanations. We tried that out in our cell in Puchong. Not necessarily wrong, but you'll get a number of explanations. And this morning, I'd like to explain that to you. Although you can define faith in various ways, the simple definition is it is a confidence and an assurance that God's word will come to pass despite your circumstances. It is a confidence, it is an assurance that God's word will come to pass despite your circumstances. I'd like to explain this. Please turn to Romans chapter 4, verse 17 to 22. Please, maybe Romans 10, please. Turn to Romans 10. Romans chapter 10. Verse 9 to verse 13. Please understand this because you're going to leave this place having clearly understood what faith is. Faith is not hoping for something to come to pass. That is hope. Hope is an expectation that something good will miraculously happen to you. Faith is knowing that it is going to happen. Let's say you're going out on a journey. Hope How does hope operate? I really wish that everything will be well. I hope that all things will go well on my journey. What does faith say? Faith steps in and says, I know that everything is going to be fine. Right? So we'll try to understand that. The situation here is, the Bible tells us here, the two elements in salvation. How do you get born again? Two elements. Number one, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Number two, you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So what are the two elements of salvation? Confession and believing, right? Take out one, there's no salvation. Confess that Jesus Christ is your Lord. Second, believe that God raised him from the dead. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. With the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The heart speaks of your spirit. So faith is not a function of your mind. Faith is a function of your spirit. Please remember that. Faith has not much to do with your mind. Faith has to do with your spirit. With your spirit, you believe and you are made righteous instantly. With your spirit, you believe and you are healed of your sicknesses. With your spirit, you believe and you are saved from the devil's snare. With your heart, you believe. With the mouth, you speak. Right? So the Bible shows us this. Why do I tell you this? Because faith operates the same way. Please look at Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 4, verse 17 to 22. The situation is this. Abraham, an old man, he's around 100 years old. His wife Sarah is 90 years old. They don't have a child, and they really want a child. They're really seeking God to give them a child. And the Bible tells us that Abraham is the father of faith. So if you want to learn about faith, where do you look? You look at Abraham, right? So this is the situation. Abraham is there, 100 years old, Sarah 90 years old. There is no way they can have a child. There is no way it's going to happen. Verse 17. I'm going to speak to you about what are the elements of faith. Verse 17. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of God whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they did. So what is the first element of faith? Abraham heard God. Right? If you don't hear God, you cannot have faith. At best, you have hope. That's why you need to study the word. You need to be a student of God's word. You need to get into the word of God, because the word of God reveals the mind of God. So in order for Abraham to have faith, the Bible says he first heard what God said. God shows up and says, I have made you a father of many nations. So in order for faith to operate in your life, you need first to hear God. What does the Bible tell us? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if you don't hear the word of God, you're not going to be able to exercise faith. You haven't cleared the first hurdle. You haven't entered the first step. Faith comes by hearing. So if you're not a lover of God's word, it's unlikely that you have faith. So the Bible tells us here in verse 18, the second element of faith. So Abraham, contrary to hope, in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. Verse 19, not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Verse 20, he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. So the second element of faith was Abraham believed what God said. His circumstances are all crying out and saying, you're crazy. Your wife can never have a child at 90. It's impossible. And Abraham, you're 100. Have you taken a look at yourself in the mirror? You can't have a child. Abraham was not concerned with that. All he needed was to hear God. And that's all you need in your situation. That's all you need in your problem. That's all you need in your battle. Hear God. What is it that God has to say? What is it that God says? Hear Him. Spend time with Him. Hear Him. Second element, Abraham simply believed what God spoke. The third element, the Bible says, please go up verse 19. He did not consider his own body, which was already dead, or the deadness of Sarah's womb. So the third element of faith is refusing to consider your circumstances. Your circumstances say that there is a pain in your back. Your circumstances say that there is a disease in your body. Your circumstances say that you've lost your job. Your circumstances say that there is a problem that you cannot overcome. Your circumstances tell you and they cry out for attention. What did Abraham do? He refused to set his mind on the circumstance. And that's what we need to do. We need to learn to fix our minds on God. God must speak. Abraham believed. And the next, he refused to consider his circumstances. Are you bankrupt? Refuse to consider your circumstances. God can bring you up. All you need is to hear God. Are you in a place where everything seems that there's no way out? You need to hear God. Are you in a place where you're sick and your body is in pain and there seems to be no healing coming? You need to lay everything aside and hear God. Spend time with the Word. Spend time listening to messages. Spend time studying it. Get to hear what God says. Number two, believing. Number three, he refused to consider or dwell on his circumstances. Number four, verse 20. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but he was strengthened in his faith. And not only that, what did he do? He began to give glory to God. He began to give glory to God. Can you imagine? The man is 100 years old. The wife is 90 years old. All he has is a promise from God. And can you imagine Abraham out in his tent or outside his tent? He is just praising God. Because when God speaks, it's done. Heaven and earth may pass away. God's word will never pass away. When God speaks, it's over. It's only time for the manifestation. And that may take a while. It doesn't matter. But all that matters is that God has spoken. I have believed it. I refuse to consider my circumstances. I begin to praise and thank God. I don't have my healing yet, but I begin to thank God. I don't have the victory yet, but I begin to thank and give glory to God. I don't have the problem still seems so big, but I begin to thank and give praise to God. Why? Because I have heard God. God has spoken to me, and there is no way that what God has spoken will not come to pass. It shall come to pass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. Amen. So what happens next? Abraham has heard. He has believed. He refuses to consider his circumstances. He begins to give praise and give glory to God. He begins to speak what God has spoken to him. I can imagine Abraham saying, I'm going to be a father of many nations. My descendants are going to be like the stars of the universe. And his servants would have thought he's crazy. Right? It's not about I will be healed. It's about by his stripes I am healed. It's not about something God will do in the past, in the future. It's about hearing God and knowing that there's no other way but for what God has spoken to come to pass. So Abraham begins to praise and thank and glorify God. And the last element of faith is simply taking action. The Bible tells us, now with all of these things, nothing would have happened unless Abraham had a sexual relationship with Sarah later, right? Right? That's action. So faith involves action. You need to act on what God's word has said. Abraham acted in faith, and guess what the result was? He got a child, and his child was named Isaac, and he became the forerunner of the nation of Israel. His descendants are like the stars of the sky. His descendants are like the sand of the seashore. What God spoke came to pass, and what God speaks in your life will come to pass. Will you take the time to sit at his feet? Will you take the time to sit down with his words? Will you take the time to read, what does his word have to say in my situation? What does it have to say? Read it and reread it and read it again and listen to it and talk about it. Let it sink into your spirit. Our whole intent in a Bible study is not to get you to memorize Bible verses. The whole intent is to get the word of God into your consciousness. The word must dominate your thinking. You need to think in accordance with God's word. The word must dominate your consciousness. It must determine your consciousness. When you get to that place, I tell you, you will walk in total victory 10 times out of 10. Every battle you will win, because faith has come in. When the word comes in, faith arises. And when faith arises, you have won. Please look at 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4. I'd like the choir to come up, please. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4. First John chapter 5 and verse 4. Please listen carefully. The Bible tells us here, everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. Are you born of God? Yes. Guess what? You can never be defeated by the world. It's impossible unless you cooperate with the world. Right? Everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world. What is it? Our faith. Our faith is the victory that gives you victory 10 times out of 10. In order for that to happen, you need to build your faith. Build it. Build it. Build it. This is the victory that overcomes the world. And that is our faith. Please look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. Second Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. You got it? Yeah, go down further. Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13, sorry. I want to show you how faith works. Verse 13. Since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and we also therefore speak. What is involved in faith here? There are two elements, believing and speaking. Right? So faith operates like that. How do you get saved? By believing and speaking. How does faith come in? When you believe what God has said and you speak it, you declare it. The Bible tells us without faith it is impossible to please God, because God is pleased by the one who takes him at his word. So I'd like to conclude this message this morning. It's about winning life's battles 10 times out of 10. And we recognize that we live in a fallen world You're going to face battles in this world. We also face battles with our flesh, with our minds, with the spirits of darkness. But God promises us that He will lead us in triumph in every battle. Please turn to 2 Corinthians 2, verse 14. In every battle, God promises not only victory, but triumph. God promises that to you this morning. Every battle that you face, you will win. You know why? The Bible tells us here, verse 14, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ. Is it sometimes? It's no. It's always. God is promising you a life of continual triumph. He is not promising you a bed of roses, but no matter what you face, you can come out a winner. You can come out a total winner. Despite the battles that we face, as long as we looked at these two elements, I want you to see that God is interested in your life. He wants to come in and work with you and bring you into a place of victory. He is your banner, Jehovah Nissi. He fights on your behalf. The second element by which we can win every battle that comes our way is faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. It's impossible. So as Christians, we are called to build our faith. How do you build your faith? By the Word. Reduce the time that you spend in front of the television. Get into the Word. Reduce the time that you waste with your friends, unbelieving friends. Get into the Word. Get into it. Dive into it. Listen to it. Speak what the Bible says. No matter what your battle is, you need to hear one word from God and you're free. One word from God can bring you out and propel you into victory. But you must be a lover of God's Word. Hallelujah. We looked at the elements of faith: hearing, believing, refusing to consider or dwell on circumstances, speaking God's word, and taking action. When God said to Abraham, leave your country, leave Ur of the Chaldeans, go to Canaan, what did Abraham do? He took action. He followed, he obeyed, he became the father of many nations. So I want to encourage you this morning, no matter what battle you face, God can set you free and propel you into triumph. Will you simply surrender your life to Him this morning? Let Him work in your life. I'd like to encourage you to stand, please, as we sing this song. And as we sing this song, I'd like you to just, if you don't know the words, don't bother, but I'd like you to simply turn your attention upon Jesus Christ. He is going to bring you out of every battle that you face. He is going to make you a victor. Just let Him do His work. Hallelujah.